Welcome, everyone, to Music Junkies, a podcast about people sharing extraordinary stories about how music has impacted their lives.
Welcome, everyone, to Music Junkies. I'm your host, Annette Spiff, and our guest today is lead vocalist of the all-female platinum-selling 80s rock band Vixen. She's also known for being the lead singer of MCA recording artist Femme to Foul. In addition, she's also a casting producer for Renegade 83 Productions, an Emmy-nominated company located in Los Angeles area. But she loves it when she's on stage performing, rocking and rolling, working on her television shows as well. She loves chasing sunsets, chilling with friends, drinking martinis, and looking for a dog to make friends with. I love it. Welcome, Lorraine Lewis. Woo! Rock out, girl. Love it.
Wow, that is quite the introduction. Holy cow, did you read my Tinder page or what?
I thought it was on OnlyFans is where I was looking you up.
Right. And I'm actually not on Tinder anymore, just so everybody knows. And the dogs on the beach, they're, you know, I like four-legged dogs better than two-legged dogs. So let's.
Yeah, I agree. I'm with you for that. I've had enough dogs in my life to last me a lifetime. Yeah,
there are plenty. But I am single, just so everybody.
We'll dive deep in that. Maybe we can hook you up with some Canadian men too.
You know? I love Canadian men. Oh, I'm going to tell you a story really quick. I posted some boots from All Saints because I do this from time to time. I put on my Instagram page, you know, in my story, and I put hell yes or oh yes, size 9. And I put like a link and oh my God, somebody messaged me and I'm getting boots and they're from Canada.
No way. I'm going to have to start doing that.
Amazing. I'm stoked right now.
That is an awesome way. Just like, hey, randomly, I need this sweater. This BMW looks pretty, just a link. Hey, if you don't ask, like you might not.
Well, you know, it's really just my wish list, right? And I'm just having fun with it. Am I really thinking that people are going to, I'm very capable of buying my own things. Trust me. However, I just throw it out there randomly, just as kind of a kook so people can see what my style is. And I don't know, somebody messaged me and said they're on their way. So I don't know. I mean, I have a post office box. We'll see what happens.
That's awesome. Just maybe don't tell them what day and time you're going to the post office.
Well, they're in Canada. No, they're coming from, like, it's a Canadian person.
Oh, that's awesome. Wow. Wait, so they really like you with the Canadian dollar so low. They're paying double.
Yeah, hilarious. I didn't know. Oops. Anyway, enough about my social life.
I love it. So before we go crazy on your playlist, what was your experience in putting those songs together for me?
Oh, gosh, I love putting the songs together for you. At first, you know, because I have an assistant, Nicole, which is why I didn't know about the link today. She's gone until Sunday, and I'm a little, like, lost without her. I hope she's listening so she knows how important she is to me. But she said, you know, you're going to have homework with this Music Junkies podcast interview. And I was like, homework? I was like, first of all, I hate chores. I hate homework. Like, fuck that. I mean, I really did say fuck that. And then she said, no, I think it's cool. And so she sent me what you were requesting. And no, I loved looking at the list and thinking of things and music that really hit me and hit my soul. And I have stories for all sorts of stuff. And, you know, it just took me back and remembering certain places and times, relationships, people, parties, friends, being on the road, all sorts of stuff. So, yeah, I thought it was a really cool idea that you had. So thank you.
Well, I'm excited because you grew up in my favorite era. Like, all the people that you hung out with were all the people that I was obsessed and in love with, right? Like, if I look at, you know, my favorite time as being, you know, a teenager, what was that time? Was when, you know, you were, you know, on stage with all of those other bands, which is really cool. So I'm excited because it's like, I get to live vicariously through you and be like, oh, okay. So we're going to like talk a lot about some of the guys back then. You know, I have some questions for you back then, just for I can like live through you a little bit. So I'm excited.
Sure, I have a list. Anyway, I'm an open book. I really am an open book. I love sharing stories and yeah, go for it.
All right. We're going to start with your first song. You ready?
Yes. I don't hear it.
AC/DC shook me all night long. You didn't hear that?
No, I'm seeing you do this, but no music.
Okay, let's see if we can make sure that the audio is working, and then my editor can just fix this. Okay, 1 second. Okay.
Oh, nice.
All right, AC/DC shook me all night long.
AC/DC, you shook me all night long. Did I put it in print that I lost my virginity to this song?
You did? No way. I love it.
OMG. First of all, I forget what I wrote on my list. So, yeah, I heard that. And yeah, I mean, I'm not going to go into details, but rock and roll all the way. AC/DC, you shook me all night long. And yeah, it was an amazing night.
Well, at least it was a night. Not that you said it was amazing 3-4 minutes.
Well, I won't go into detail, but it was not my prom night, but it was my date's prom night, and I was his prom date. But I'm not going to tell you what year that was, because I went to all sorts of parties and stuff. But anyway, yes, AC/DC, you shook me all night long, right out the gate. I'm spilling my guts, but here we go.
I love AC/DC. I'm assuming you were young, right? We were all kind of young back then, doing crazy things back then. So I'm assuming you were probably teenage years. So if you were in your teenage years, what were you like in high school?
Oh, I was the total nerd in high school. I was a complete nerd. I was the girl. Every high school had one of these. I was the girl with the guitar that would carry the guitar around. That was me. I had an acoustic guitar that I took to school with me. I was kind of a loner, although I knew, it's like, I felt like everybody knew me in high school, but I didn't hang out with people. Like, I wasn't a cheerleader. I wasn't a jock. I didn't really like sports. I liked music. I liked art. I wasn't in theater, but I did musicals. I was in concert choir with a mixed choir. I auditioned for state choir and I made it. But I was the girl sitting on the lawn at lunchtime by herself with her guitar, just hanging out, writing songs and eating lunch alone. That really was me, until a football player asked me out. And I don't know, my perspective on life kind of changed. We didn't really date or anything, but I still carried my guitar and took it to school, but it seemed like I got more popular after that.
Oh, interesting. What kind of posters did you have on your wall? Who were the guys that were on your wall or the girls on your wall?
Well, interestingly enough, I come from a family of 6 kids. So we shared rooms. Oh. So my brother's room, my 2 brothers shared a room, and it was Kiss posters everywhere. But my room, my sister was really into Janis Joplin. I was into David Cassidy. Yes. I was into Bobby Sherman. I really loved the Fifth Dimension. I love Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young, Lynyrd Skynyrd, Linda Ronstadt. And then there was Van Halen.
Oh, wow.
And that changed everything for me, because you got to understand, I'm from Albuquerque, New Mexico, you know, it not really like Texas, but, you know, Hispanic, Mexican, Texan, Nuevo Mexico. So more Southern rock was on the menu back then. And I actually was in a band. My first top 40 band was a band called West Wind. And I used to wear all black, and I used to wear a black cowboy hat, and I did Linda Ronstadt covers and all that kind of Southern rock music. That was embedded in me. It was Southern rock. And it wasn't until the first Van Halen record came out that I went to Van Halen, and I stood on my chair all night at the Albuquerque Civic Auditorium. And David Lee Roth comes out crotch first, sexy as all fuck, ripped, flowing hair like a god. And I was like, holy moly, I love this guy. And it wasn't really, though, that I wanted to date Dave. And I've said this before, I wanted to be Dave. I loved everything about him. I remember my sisters and some of her friends, they were really into trying to hook up with the band and the band members, and they knew where their after party was. It was the Hilton Inn in downtown Albuquerque. And I didn't even go. Like I just didn't consider myself a groupie ever. And so I just didn't even partake in any of that. I mean, I really wanted to, that was sign, seal, delivered. I want to be a rock star like David Lee Roth. That was it.
He had amazing stage presence. Oh, gosh. For sure.
100%. And, you know, recently, I am going to say this, Tommy London, that's on Sirius Satellite Radio, about 3 months ago, he was on the air and he sent it to me, and he actually called me. I mean, it's embarrassing to say, but he called me like the best thing, like the next best David Lee Roth persona on stage, and said that like my stage presence is, he called me one of the best stage personalities ever, like on the planet. Yeah. And so that meant so much to me. Thank you, Tommy London. It meant so much to me. And he had seen us at M3. And just to know that David Lee Roth left such an impression on me, and I was just determined to, you know, get people rocking. That's my job on stage, is to get people in the zone, in the mood, on your feet. We're not sitting down watching a movie. We're not sitting here eating popcorn in the front row. No, yeah. We're here to rock. And that's what my job is. And that's what I love. And that's why I love doing what I do. I feel most comfortable when I'm on stage. This everyday life stuff is a little more challenging for me. I'm not 100% comfortable. I don't really know. I'm awkward and all that kind of stuff. And hence the girl on the lawn in high school. I'm still that girl is there. No matter how many thousands of people I performed for, there's still, you know, this awkward girl in real life. But get me on stage. I know exactly what I'm going to do, and I'm going to rock your face off.
I love it. What was your first song that you learned on the guitar?
Well, the first song is a song that I wrote, and it was like a cheesy little, come down to my place, we'll have some fun. Come down to my place, yes, come everyone. I mean, and you can hear the Southern flavor in that. I mean, that's really, you know, my jam. But I will say, You Shook Me All Night Long. As a matter of fact, later tonight, I have a rehearsal because I'm doing a solo side project. And that is one of the songs on the set because I know it so well inside and out. An easy chord.
That's right. So,
yeah, D-A-G, D-A-G, D-A-G kind of thing. It's so easy. But yeah, that's the first song I learned on guitar. And I'm a rhythm player. I'm not a lead player like Britt Lightning Fingers. I'm a solid rhythm player. Nothing too fancy, just solid. But I love it.
I love it. All right. I know you have lots of stories about these guys. So we're going to play your next song. Cheap Trick. You know, I'm from Nanaimo, BC, and I think it was them and who sings Patio Lanterns? How come I can't think of his name? And Brian Adams. That's all we ever got in Nanaimo. Those three bands. That's it. We never got anybody else.
Well, let me just say, even when you just put that on just now, I get chills completely all over my body. I still have them, and I get like teary-eyed and emotional. That song is so good. That tour was so great. We were a baby band right out of the gate, right? And it was on my birthday that I got a phone call from HK Management. That was my manager at the time, Howard Kaufman, may he rest in peace. A life changer, that man, for me. He bought me my boobs, my first boobs, I should say. but yes, he was my manager, and he called me on my birthday. And he said, happy birthday. How would you like to go out on tour with Cheap Trick? And I said, are you telling me something? And he said, congratulations and happy birthday. You're going on tour with Cheap Trick. And that was like the best birthday gift ever. The flame was out. It's such an amazing song. I couldn't believe we were going to go out on tour with them, number one. And number two, to be on tour with them, first of all, they treated us so great, just right off the get-go. They were so cool to us. Like, we really had no clue as to what we were doing. There was a limo that picked us up to take us to LAX, which is really cool. There's a story later. I actually have some Polaroids from that day. And I've got a release coming out the end of the month, and those pictures are going to show up there. But, you know, they send over a limo to pick us up, to take us to LAX. And it's like, here I am, you know, this girl that used to sit on the lawn in Albuquerque, New Mexico. I'm getting picked up in a limo and I'm going on tour with Cheap Trick. I mean, holy fuck. That's huge, huge, huge. So, you know, we get there, we meet the guys. They're really nice to us. They kind of took us under our wing, under their wing. Robin and I would chit chat. I learned from him not to talk during the day to save your voice. Because when I first met him, he wasn't really saying much. And I didn't think he was stuck up. I just thought he just didn't know us well and da 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 da. But no, later I find out that he just doesn't talk during the day. And that was the best advice that I could get, because when you're doing promo tours and you're the fans and all your friends and all the stuff and you're getting hyped up during the day, you can burn out before you hit the stage. And so I always hear Robin's voice with that, you know, like let the band carry stuff during the day. Let the band do interviews during the day. Let the band be the voice for the fans when you're doing meet and greets and stuff like that, and save your voice for the show. And he saved his voice for the show every night. He would hit those notes on the flame every fucking night. I had the best spot in the house because I got to be on the side of the stage watching them perform. And God, what a great magical moment watching him, just such a great vocal pro, and still is. Robin is top notch for sure. So had a blast with them. The song is really great. Goosebumps, like I say, really tasty choice in all of his notes that he goes for, and such a great message, you know, the flame and just keeping the fire burning and the flame alive. And woo, yeah, good memories of Cheap Trick. Love them to this day.
So obviously you were fairly new in the industry when you started touring with them. Besides kind of saving your voice, was there other things that you really learned that you were able to carry with you guys as a band? Because obviously you probably toured with other bands, and you know, if they were so influential, and then maybe you went and seen another band, you're like, oh God, this is not how you're supposed to do it.
Well, a couple other things that I loved about them is that the first night this didn't happen, but after it's kind of like we did our first show with them and they watched and they thought we were great. And I think that we earned their respect. And because of that, Robin let me use his monitor system.
Wow.
So, you know, typically, at least from what I've heard, I don't know really from experience, and surely Vixen doesn't do this, but opening bands get the short end of the stick usually. There's not enough room on stage. You know, the big band takes over everything and you're left with just crumbs. But, and we had our sound man on tour with us, Jeff Dunn and Joe Crippen, but we didn't have a great monitor setup. We just didn't have the equipment or the money to do so. And after the first night, Robin told our sound man, like, go ahead and use the rig for Lorraine's voice. Like she can use my monitors. So really cool. Props to them. And just their stage presence and their magic. I mean, we just learned so much hanging out with them. And I, you know, had so much fun with them. The very last night of the tour, it's traditional to do something goofy to the opening band. And they had a big net above the stage that came down on me and us. And yeah, just really great, great memories of them. I would tour with them again in a second. Oh, yeah. I love Cheap Trick. Yeah.
All right. Our next song.
On the meter of what's hot and hot as hell. We're beyond the corner, no return as far as I can tell.
Yeah, Vixen. I love it.
Vixen, the new single from Vixen, we put out 4 months ago called Red, written by Fred Corey, produced by Fred Corey. Yeah, we had a great time with this song. It's a song that Roxy heard first, is what I believe, and then presented it to us. You know, she was looking for a song that was indicative. Yes, we have written together. Yes, we have been writing together. But we hadn't really found that song that defined us, where we were at in 2023 as a band collectively. You know, Roxy, original drummer, me from Femme Fatale, Julia Lage, amazing bass player from Brazil, Britt Lightning, who's been in the band for about 8 years now. But I think Roxy was looking for a song that collectively spoke to her and defined who we were as a band. And it's energetic, it's in your face, it's sexy, it's fresh, it's new, it sounds current, it doesn't sound like 1988, although it was important to her and to us to keep the harmonies, the Vixen harmonies present. And so we do that, and they're really stacked in there. But yeah, I love the song. We've only performed it 3 times because we released it and then we were on hiatus over the holidays. We did a show right before Christmas and just felt so great to do that song. And people knew, you know, you get that guitar, that riff going right at the beginning, and everybody knew what was coming. And you start hearing red, red, red in the audience, which was so cool. It went over great. And then we performed in January, and we've done the song twice in January. So I can't wait to get back out on the road and just kill it. You know, it sounds amazing. Obviously, the more you do a song collectively and together, it's going to gel even more and be more in your face. So I can't wait. But yeah, I love the song so much. It feels great to do it. And I'm honored and grateful to have my voice on a Vixen song for history forever.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty amazing. Who would have thought?
What do you think is the difference between the crowds in the 80s and the crowds now? Like, do you see like a huge difference?
Gosh, I don't know that I see a huge difference. I think people are hungry to rock and roll. I think back in the day, I don't know, it seemed like when we were on tour, Femme Fatale, it was heavy male. I think now it is a mix, maybe even more female, maybe. But I would say that that's the biggest difference that I see. Now, is that because Femme Fatale, you know, in your face, sex bombshell approach, you know, songs like Waiting for the Big One, My Baby's Gun, Touch and Go. I mean, come on. I wasn't inventing the wheel. But was it just indicative of the time that, you know, like it was young guys that wanted to go out and rock and roll? I mean, there's a photo, another Polaroid that's going to be on the record. And it's Z-Rock Dallas. And it is all guys with their arms up screaming. I don't see one brave girl in the mix anywhere. So, you know, was it guys that was just coming to the shows back then? It was a guy thing to do. I don't know. That's such an interesting question. I would love to bring that up with Roxy even. And what were the audiences like? Was it predominantly male or was it a mix? Because yeah. I don't know. But then today, you know, obviously people are a little bit older.
Yeah, we have so much rules now. It's, you know, we just went to Warrant and Quiet Riot weeks ago. And this was the first time ever. Like, I couldn't even believe it. People, like 90% of the crowd were sitting down. And I'm like, I don't understand what's happening. Like, it was actually like uncomfortable. Like when I stood up, I was like, how come like nobody else is standing up? I don't understand it. What? And it was the first time ever. Like most of the time when there's chairs, everybody still stands up. This is the first time ever that I was like, this is fucking weird. Like, you guys need to stay. Like, they're doing Bang Your Head and you're sitting in a fucking chair. Like, I'm not understanding what's happening right now.
Yeah, see, I love those boys. And that is really surprising to me because every show I've seen, they get people up on their feet immediately. So I'm surprised at that.
I know.
But that it's not my jam. Like I say, that is my job. My job when I come out, and if you're sitting down, it's, you know, I'll allow it for just a minute while I get my bearings when I'm out there. But then it's like, no, it's full on. And, you know, we're livening it up. I mean, that's my job, is to get people on their feet, get people's fists in the air, horns up, like, let's go. Let's best life ever. So, yeah, I'm surprised to hear that. And did they sit the whole night? No,
they sat the whole night. Like it was so bizarre. I didn't, I stood, but I was in third row. So I was like, fuck, I don't care, whatever, you guys look around, whatever. But it was the weirdest thing I've ever experienced. I was like, what is happening? Because for me, when I go to a show, I want to be entertained. This is why I always continue to go to rock shows. It's like, we went to go see Kiss a little while ago, and you know, everybody's like, I can't believe you're sitting so close to the stage, they got like 900 flames gonna shoot out and burn you, and
hey,
we were sweating our asses off. I wish I had bra tops on, because we were like, me and my girlfriend were dying, and like, it was so fun though. But it's crazy, this is why I continue to go to rock shows though, because the shows nowadays, it's boring.
I want to be entertained. I want to feel the heat. I want to sweat. I want to scream. I want to be hoarse at the end of the night. It's rock and roll. Like, let's have fun.
That's fun. Yeah, I agree. It's crazy.
It's that age thing though. No. You've got like people know, just because you're over 35 or 40, no, it's still rock and roll. Like, no, we have, no, it's, yeah.
You know, it drives me crazy. All right, next song is awesome. I love this song. These goals to keep me company. Jelly Roll, Son of a Sinner.
Chills, another chill song. Dang. I mean, I could cry right now. What, that's like two bars of a song? Jelly Roll knows how to write a song. Jelly Roll knows how to connect with the people. Jelly Roll is a broken soul that is revived and alive and changing lives. This guy. I learned about Jelly Roll, 7 years ago. Saw him in downtown LA. I don't even remember the venue, just little pop-up kind of a place, probably 200 people there, maybe, Slugger Jennings. Wait, what is his name? It's not coming to me. Anyway, one of his sidekicks that he's written a bunch of songs with. I want to say Yellow Wolf was there too, but I don't know for sure. But they were this outlaw group that would tour together. I was communicating with his wife, Bunny, because I was creating a reality show, or potentially creating a reality show around her and her outlaw wives, with Bobby Collin, who used to manage Lita Ford. Bobby Collin is a real good friend of mine. He's a manager. And he knew that I had created and co-created and was an EP on the show Ex-Wives of Rock. And so he said, I know this couple, I know this girl, this woman, and she's like an outlaw wife and she's got friends. And so I was putting something together and I was starting to do interviews with them. And Yellow Wolf's wife, Fifi Dobson from Canada. And so I was trying to put this thing together. And so Jelly Roll was going to be in town and Bunny was going to be with him. And so I went to the show to meet her and to meet him. And I was blown away by him and her. Drop dead gorgeous she is. This was so long ago. Oh my goodness. And I'll never forget. We left the venue before their show to went to go get a drink, a cocktail together, and kind of talk business. I was so enthralled with him. I was so blown away by his magnetism, he was so sexy. He was so, I can't even explain it. And he's a very big man. You know, we all know, I don't know what he weighs. It didn't matter. He's tall, he's big. but he was so charismatic. I could not take my eyes off him. I could not just stop talking to him. He was so cool, just so cool and so confident and so kind and just authentic and the real deal. They are the shit is all I can say. Bunny XO, Bunny and Jelly Roll are just the it couple of the year. They're the it couple of the decade, as far as I'm concerned. They're amazing. They're changing lives. You know, they've reformed their lives. If people don't know about them, you should Google and find out more about their past. But they are amazing human beings. And I remember thinking, when I was talking to Jelly, and we were trying to get something going with Bunny, and I thought, these two don't need me at all. Yes, I work at a production company. Yes, I did X, Y, Z of Rock, but I was like, they don't need me. I know that they are destined for greatness. So it is pretty effing amazing to see all of the things that they do all the time, and they're just killing it. So yeah, that song is amazing. Killer songs. They're taking over the world. Bunny has her own podcast, Dumb Blonde podcast. I mean, they're just amazing. You know, I went through a divorce. I've been married a bunch of times. She's the first and only person when I was starting to go through these thoughts in my head of leaving my marriage. She's the person that I reached out to. I texted her. Because I knew that she wouldn't judge me. I knew that she would tell it to me straight. And I just, you know, I didn't want anybody in my circle to even know that I was having these thoughts. Bunny is the real deal. I remember it was 4th of July and she messaged me back. She's like, I'm at a 4th of July party, but how, you know, like I'm here for you. And she was messaging me and it was pretty cool. So yeah, my hat off to those two. Jelly Roll is just going to keep on climbing up the charts and doing amazing things. Maybe he runs for president someday.
You never know. You never know. So who knows, right?
Yeah. They are amazing. Amazing. Yeah. Real deal.
I love how you speak about them. You know, when I think of, it's very rare to have people like that in your life. You know, I know as we get older, I feel like we have these core groups in, you know, maybe elementary, high school, and then we go through, you know, this kind of gap. And then I feel like a lot of us are searching for those types of friends. And everybody is so busy that it's so hard to connect. So the fact that you speak about them like that gives me chills, because I want people to talk like that about me as a friend, or I even want to go meet people like that, for they can be in my social circle. So
yeah, well, and you know, and don't get me wrong. I mean, I don't hang out with them, you know, on the daily or anything like that. I mean, we message each other occasionally now on Instagram or text message, etc. She's not someone I talk to every day by any means, but you know, she was the one person I knew that I could trust with my secret. She's the one person that I knew that would be straight with me. And I really respect them and everything that they've done, you know, it's just amazing. Yeah. I can see us at the bar. Like, it's just, and just again, knowing that I just looked at him and just thought, you guys don't need me. You guys have a magic going on that just is so enormous that I don't even know what to do with you.
Yeah. I love
you
it.
Guys do. Yeah. Pretty cool.
It Woo. Is very cool. All right. Next song. Hey, this is a song I've never heard until I listened to your playlist. So it was pretty cool. This is my favorite part about doing this podcast is I get like all of this new music, right? I love it.
Yeah, Måneskin from Italy. Woo! Chills again. Okay, so 2021, I guess it was. I'm living in Washington State at my little condo, and I'm going to watch the Eurovision Songwriting Contest. And it's on a Sunday, and I'm really excited. I had seen the movie Eurovision, like the songwriting contest. Is that what it's called? Eurovision? I think that's what it is. And so I was really excited. I had champagne and I'm just making a sundae of it. And I'm watching, I'm sitting on the couch, I'm drinking my champagne. And all of a sudden, Måneskin comes on with that song. It's Italian. I don't know how to say the title even. Something Bonita, I don't even know. But they were so cool. Victoria on bass, female bass player, beautiful drummer with long black hair. Elon, is that his name? Evan? And guitar player, his name is eluding me right now. Gorgeous, young, all wearing these cool outfits that were not matchy-matchy, but similar. Like they were, like it was thought out. And then, oh my gosh, Demiano on vocals. Holy cow. So rock and roll, so in your face, so fearless. I loved him. I love them collectively together. His voice, such a rock god voice, you know, such a rock, total rock god voice, just gritty and strong and hot. And oh God, they blew my mind. There were other bands that were good, other performers that were good, but I was now on the edge of my seat. Now I was invested. Now they have to win. And I still have video on my phone of when I'm like totally I'm like this watching and waiting for them to announce the winner. And I videotape them winning. It was just the coolest moment. And I knew again, like with Jelly Roll, it's like, sometimes you just know, it's so in your face. It's so obvious. At least it is with me, that I knew that they were destined for greatness. I knew they were going to be huge. I mean, then they opened up for the Rolling Stones. Then they went on a world tour. I got to see them at the Whiskey. Was it the Whiskey? You know, the Roxy, September of 2022. Amazing show. God, just so great. So up close and personal with them. I didn't meet them or anything like that. I was totally in the audience. Tickets were like $300 a piece. I didn't care. It was such a great show, and they have just continued to release great music. Their spirit is great. World tours, people are loving them. They look so cool in their clothes. I mean, they are just the epitome of rock and roll. They're just living life to the fullest, you know?
Yeah.
Have you seen them perform at all online?
I haven't, but I'm going to go. I just listened to, I loved your playlist, so I listened to it quite a few times, but I loved them. I was like, oh, this is really cool. I miss the days where you like had MTV and you could just go sit there for hours and hours and hours and just watch videos and listen to music. Yeah.
Well, that's why I was so excited to watch the songwriting contest, the Eurovision song, because it's like you don't really get to watch new music anymore. And so it was a big deal for me. It was a Sunday, and I watched again last year. I think it comes out every April, so it'll come out again this year. But a great way to see new music from all over the world.
Yeah.
And they have just stood the test of time these last few years. They're killing it. They're killing it. I love them. I love them, love them. I would love to sing with him. He's killer.
Yeah, he is killer for sure. So let's kind of rewind. Take me back to, you know, LA, Sunset Boulevard, Roxy. Take me back to kind of those days. You know, how old were you when you were running in that scene?
So I was, when I got my record deal, I was 29 years old.
Wow.
We lied about my age and said I was 24. So if you Google my age, you'll see two different ages. You'll see 65 and you will see 60, because we took off 5 years back then. My bass player brother was my older brother in the band, but he was really my younger brother. But that's just some dumb thing that we did, partly because of me, because 29 sounded old to me. Yeah, so I probably moved to LA when I was 20. Well, I moved to LA twice. I moved to LA probably when I was 25, 26. Felt that Albuquerque was way too small for me, and moved to LA to make my dreams come true. And then was like, holy shit, I'm in LA. This is terrifying. I don't know what I'm doing. So I went back. And the thing with that scenario is, once you've come to LA, if that's what's your destiny and that's what you want, there's no turning back at that point. I mean, I thought I could go back to Albuquerque. No way. No way. Now I had tasted LA, the big city, yeah. The big lights, magic. You know, the diamond field of lights when you come over to Mulholland, you know, it's like, that's a part of who I am, you know, watching police chases and things like that I had never experienced before until I came to LA. That was the first time I ever literally saw a policeman with a gun drawn on a suspect in the street.
Wow.
And it was like, is this TV? Are we the show? Like, I had no idea what was going on, but it was real life. So once you, for me anyway, once I tasted those kinds of things and I went back to Albuquerque, it was like, oh, hell no, fuck no, I can't. There's no way I can live here now. Like, I knew I couldn't really live here.
Yeah.
That's why I left. But then I left and I came back. Oh, yeah, hell no, I really can't live here now. No, this place is way too small for me. And not to diss Albuquerque, look, Albuquerque is a great place for a lot of people. A lot of people never left. I get that. But for me, just not my thing. I have a lot of fans there. I love Albuquerqueans. I love where I came from. I just didn't see myself living there forever and starting a family and doing all that stuff. And yeah, just not my thing. So,
when you were kind of out in the scene, how would your night kind of go? You would start at this bar, but you always ended at what bar?
Well, we would start at the FM station in the Valley. It seemed like that was like the hub for the locals. Cause like we up and coming bands lived in the Valley. You know, we all lived in the Valley because that's where the rent was the cheapest. And we would head out to Hollywood where the action was, but we would congregate at the FM station. A lot of bands came through there. And then, you know, I don't even remember. I didn't have a car. I was in LA without a vehicle. So, and there was no Uber. So it's so weird to think about. Friends would pick me up. Guys I was dating would pick me up. I mean, you would just end up on the Sunset Strip. All of us would end up on the Sunset Strip. And there would be flyers everywhere. And you would see Ricky Rocket. And you would see Bret Michaels. And everybody flyers and this and that. And then up and coming metal bands and Bang Tango. And just the vibe was just so great. And we were all friends with everybody.
Yeah.
You know, there was a place called Spice on Hollywood Boulevard that a guy, Biff Malibu, his name is Jeff Coggins, lifelong friend. And he used to run a night there on Thursday nights, rock and roll. And all these bands would kill, like, we would all congregate there and then we'd end up on stage together. And I remember one night, and I have video footage of this, I'll post sometime. It's Tone Loc, Funky Cold Medina, Ricky Rocket on drums, Sean McNabb on bass, when he had his really curly hair. That's when he was in Quiet Riot for a minute back then. I think that that's the band that he was in. I don't mean for a minute. I don't know how long he was in that band, but he was in Quiet Riot. Mitch Perry on guitar, me on vocals, and we're just, I don't know, Tone started doing Funky Cold Medina kind of a thing, and then I just jumped up on the mic, and then we started doing this like ad-libby thing, and then Ricky's just playing, and then we went into Honky Tonk Woman. It was just, that's just kind of how it went. And then we would just end up in a mansion in the hills. I don't know how I got there. I don't even know how I got home. And I didn't do drugs back then. I drank. I mean, I partied in college. Those were my party days. I dated the biggest cocaine dealer in my hometown. But I wasn't ever a big user of drugs or weed. Weed made me paranoid. So I wasn't a partier. I like a cocktail now and then. But Yeah, I wasn't doing drugs on the Sunset Strip. Nobody was. I remember we would drink, we would hang out, we would laugh. And, you know, it was just so much fun getting ready to go out and hairspray and makeup and tight clothes and all of that stuff and being out with your friends. I mean, those were the best of times.
What were your boyfriends like back then?
Well, I didn't really have a boyfriend per se, but there was a guy named Nigel Marks that I was dating. He was a singer and a bass player. It's like everybody was a musician.
Yeah.
Like everybody in the world was a musician that I hung, but anybody in my circle was a musician. I did date Ricky Rocket back in the day. You know, I remember like for the show at Spice, we pulled up, I would ride on the back of Ricky's Harley a lot. That's how he got around town. And I remember being on the back of his bike and we roll into Hollywood and with all these other bikes. He used to ride with a group called the Lost Boys. It was a motorcycle group of friends. And God, we just had the best time. I was hanging out with him. I was hanging out with Jeff Young from Megadeth. I didn't really date him. We did a lot of songwriting together. I think Jeff wanted to date me. Sorry, Jeff, I think you did. You tried. But I just didn't, you know, we didn't ever date. I thought he was, you know, he was cool. He was Jeff Young. He was a great songwriter, great guitar player. And then, I'll just tell you one thing. Back in the 80s, the best way to get a date in rock and roll is to have a video on MTV. There, I said it.
There you go. And everybody was trying to get videos there. That was a thing to do.
Videos were the way. My management company would get calls from various rock stars.
give me three.
Oh gosh. John Waite called the office. And I love John Waite. I love John Waite. I think I can only give you one. I'm only going to give you one. And John Waite, I would love to sing with you sometime. You have the killer voice. We never went out on a date, but I remember I'm girl talking. You know, I had a answering machine back in the day. We all did. And management gave him my phone number and he left a message on my answering machine and inviting me to dinner with that beautiful English accent. I mean, how cool, you know?
Very cool.
Yeah. Good times. Awesome. I've had a lot of fun. There will be a book at some point.
Yeah, you need to. All right.
Yeah.
Ain't got no regrets. I ain't losing track of which way I'm going. Did I trigger a memory?
Holy cow. Well, Lou Graham. I mean, listen to that voice.
I know. It's very sexy.
Lou Graham's voice. Lou Graham is the epitome of rock and roll. That voice is magic. I mean, so many hit songs, Jukebox Hero. Lou Graham has an amazing fucking voice. And I can't say enough about his voice. And I mean, I grew up with those songs. I performed Hot Blooded at the Santa Monica Civic with the Party Ninjas. The Party Ninjas was a group of musicians in LA that would get together for Find the Children. It was an organization, you know, when they had the faces on the milk cartons back in the day, there was an organization trying to find the children, you know, probably, you know, children being trafficked and all that. Those were like the beginning stages of all of that kind of stuff. And so I got invited to perform at the Party Ninjas. I got invited by Vince Neil from Motley Crue.
I love Vince Neil. That was my guy growing up for sure.
Yeah. So he put me on the bill with them. such a dream come true. I mean, these guys were all so cool to me. Like when you think about that, you know, did they want to date me? Maybe, yes, maybe no, I don't know. But all I know is that I've had some amazing experiences with the rock and roll community from the 80s and just people opening the door for me and being cool to me without expecting anything in return. I mean, I never saw a casting couch. I never did any of that kind of stuff to get anywhere. I think that a lot of people assume those kinds of things when females are involved in rock and roll or in TV or in movies. That stuff never happened to me. And maybe because when you meet me, you know that I'm the real deal. I'm authentic and I speak from my heart and I take no bullshit. At the same time, I am gullible for sure. And I drink the Kool-Aid, but I think that there is a side of me that people get a sense of that you're not going to get over on me necessarily.
And they probably see talent as well, right? You don't need to get to the front of the stage. You know what I mean? You're who you are and you're talented. So it's not like they can convince you to do something in order for you to become something because they don't, you don't need them to go become something.
Yeah. No, I never did, but really nice to have doors open, really nice for Vince to invite me to play at the Party Ninjas. I mean, I was the only girl on stage. Like those moments, you know, and back then that's how it was. I mean, there, you know, Lita Ford, Vixen, Soraya, Doro Pesch, maybe a few others that I can't even remember, but it was a male dominated sport and still is to a very strong degree. But I just feel so lucky and fortunate that I was able to climb through somehow and make a mark somehow, even though on radio it would be one female being played and not all of us. And I knew, and I've told this story many times, when I would walk into the on the PR tour, walk into the radio station, if there was a poster of Lita Ford, I knew that we weren't going to get that station. If there was a photo or a poster of Vixen, I knew we weren't going to get that station. But if I just walked in and it was Winger and Guns N' Roses, we have a chance for this station, guys. And so, pretty amazing times, but wouldn't change any of it.
I love that you know, when I interview a lot of people, and we do talk about the 80s a little bit, and I just finished watching the documentary on... Jesus, I'm drawing a blank. Anyways, We Are the World. I just watched the documentary for that.
About that.
But you triggered something when you said the faces on the milk cartons. And if I look at like kind of today's day and age compared to the, you know, the 80s day and age, I feel like even though the 80s was kind of like a gong show and lots of partying and all this kind of craziness, I do feel like that era was really huge on protecting children, getting education out about AIDS and gay
awareness.
Awareness. Yes, I feel like they do it now, but it's very separate now. It's like, look at me, I am doing this and I'm going to give to this charity, where I felt like back then it was like, hey, you're good at this. We're all good at this. We all, you know, we all have our own ego, but we're all coming together to kind of do that. And I feel like that is really what, that's why people never give up the 80s. It just felt like a family.
It really did. And, you know, and that, you know, going back to the Sunset Strip, it was a family. Like I say, there wasn't anything rude going on. Like it was just party, fun, community, people jumping into cars, going to some mansion in the hills, hanging out. I never saw anything. I never witnessed anything weird or vulgar. I mean, but then, I mean, I wasn't hanging out with Guns N' Roses and that vibe, you know. I mean, I know that they have lots of stories that are living on the edge, but what I experienced was really just fun and games and unity and people just having a great time and being there for each other. Yeah. And again, I don't know how I got there. I don't know how I got home, but man, we did have fun.
I love it. All right. Next song. I'm going to fast forward this one a bit. Right. The Cult.
Jeez. Yeah. The Cult, one of my all-time favorite bands. When I'm posting, they're usually one of my go-to songs that I choose. I love them so much. The energy of The Cult, and so different, you know, like Ian Asprey, so cool, his vocal, haunting, and like, I never met him, but just more, I don't know, witchy poo, like, I don't know.
Curious. Yes. Yeah. Like, so leather pants, that's all you see. You hear him sing and you think he's shirtless and wearing leather pants.
Yes, so cool, so sexy. And then that guitar, Billy Duffy on guitar, killer guitar player. I love the, anytime this song comes on, I'm dancing on a table. I don't care. Anytime this song comes on, I am dancing. I'm going crazy. I can even see myself living in Seattle and it coming on and me just at a bar, just going nuts. And I love everything about this song. Billy Duffy, I do have a story with Billy. He probably doesn't remember this, but I went to the MTV Awards with Ricky Rocket. I was on the back of his bike. Might have been 89, I don't know the year. But I was there. I'm not really sure of the year. Was I with Ricky that year? I don't know. I went a couple times. Anyway, all I remember is Billy Duffy walking by me and us saying hi, and I had my manager, and I had a dress on. Yeah, so this was a different, I wasn't with Ricky. This was a different MTV. And he got on the ground and lay down for me and looked up my dress as I walked by. I can't remember if I put on a show and walked over him, because then it's like, okay, is this what we're doing? Because I'm, again, I'm always here to entertain. But Billy did that and looked up my dress. So not every woman can say that about Billy Duffy from The Cult. And he probably doesn't remember. And I really haven't seen him in years. And I don't even know if he would know me from the next person. But that's my Billy Duffy story. And I'm sticking with it. It happened.
What are some crazy things that you've done on stage over the years?
I feel like you might know the answer to this question. Do you know the answer to this question?
Really? I like to like keep it really minimal because I want to experience it too.
Wow. Well, that is so cool this is a great question. A lot of people probably don't even know this. If you never saw Femme Fatale live, you wouldn't know this because there's not a lot of documentation on it. But do you remember a band called The Divinals, Christina Amphlett?
Yeah. Yeah.
I was a huge fan of her, amazing voice. And she used to, she was kind of punk rockish, right? And she used to get lipstick. And in this one song, I forget what it was, and she was just, like, just do this thing and draw lipstick all over her face, right? And I thought that that was so fucking cool. However, I'm not punk rock girl, and I don't want to really mess up my makeup, because I want to be sexy, pretty girl. That's the truth. Yeah. So I came up with my own little stunt, and I would get spray paint. I had spray paint on tour with me, but I would get, I started with the hair colors, the like spray paint, but it's washable. I would get hot pink, but they didn't have that in every town. So I would also have silver, real spray paint just in case. And I would spray paint myself on stage.
Oh, wow.
So Cradles Rockin' would come on at the very beginning. There's like a big jungle beat drum thing going on with Bobby. And it's so fucking cool and sexy. And there I am in my short shorts, and there would be my spray paint by the drum kit, and I would pick up the spray can, and here we go. Now I'm putting on a show, and I start spray painting, and I'm like, you know, I'm doing the Lorraine pose, which is, if you know anything about me, I've got a pose, and it's like butt up and chest out and, you know, Jesus on the cross kind of a thing. I'm going to hell, I know. But anyway, I would start spray painting. Dan, 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 dan. Then I'd go to my legs, and I would just do this whole thing. And then right before the song, bum, bum, and then gun, 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 gun. On that, I would throw the spray can away, and then now it's hair flying, and we're all rocking, and we go into the song. But that was the intro to Cradles Rockin', and I did that every night on tour, and I loved it. And it was just a show-stopping moment where, for me, it wasn't communicating with the crowd with my words. It was communicating with the crowd, like, I'm going to put on a show, and there would be a light on me. And it was just kind of my moment to just cut loose and be rock and roll and, like, do something different. I'd never seen anybody else do that before.
No.
So that was my thing. So there is a write-up about it at one college that I found, because I Googled it a few months ago, because I'm going to do a post about it. Because, yeah, a lot of people, that's why I love that you asked that question. A lot of people don't know that about me, that I, you know, I've always been fearless. I like I say, I'm an entertainer. I'm here to put on a show. And that was part of the show. And if you're going to sit in the audience, I want to entertain you. And, you know, sorry, but you're going to get entertained, whether you like it or not. And it might not be your exact type of entertainment, but you're going to have something to talk about tomorrow, because I want that for me. I want something to talk about when I go see a show.
Yeah.
But yeah, do that. And there's pictures that you'll see. Now you'll be aware that, you'll see photos of my studded boots. And if you see splashes of hot pink paint, hot pink or silver, you'll know what that's from. It's from my performance and the paint getting on my boots. And, you know, and it would come off easy when it was the hair dye, but then there's some, I mean, I have a photo of me with just silver, just
all over. I was going to say, what is that like trying to come off every night?
Yeah, it was easy with the hair stuff, but not easy with the real spray paint, for sure. And it was lots of baby oil, I remember. But those photos, you know, I am releasing a live Femme Fatale when we tour with Cheap Trick. It's demos from the first record and also live from when we toured with Cheap Trick. And it's the whole show, one of our whole shows in Normal, Illinois.
Wow.
The booklet is so amazing. It's an 18-page booklet, and all of these Polaroid shots are in there. And there's photos of me during that moment that we're talking about. And I'm on the floor in one of them, and I've got my head back. It's all very showgirl. It's all very,
I love it,
stripper-esque. It's all very showman. And I'm just like, I just putting on a show, man, having the time of my life. Are you kidding me? So yeah, those pictures are in there, and it brings back really good memories. Just the best time. I mean, I don't do that now. I don't do that in Vixen, you know, but there was a time and place for that, for sure. You know, when you're in your 20s and you just grabbing the world by, you know.
What do you have coming? What do you have going on, say, over the next 6 months?
Well, gosh, there's so many things going on for Vixen. You know, we just got a bunch of dates that have come in. We're going to be really, really busy this spring and summer.
Are you coming to Canada at all?
I haven't seen that on the list yet, but, you know, we were just there. Where were we? I forget what city we were in. We were there in 2022. That's where my 27,000 Instagram that day got hacked, and I had to start over. Yeah. Yeah, I'm at to almost 12,000 now, but yeah, 27,000, just like it vanished. I spent $2,000 trying to get it back. I was being held hostage. They basically, somebody messaged me and said I could buy my account back. I went to the dark web trying to get it back. I mean, it was crazy. So then I just said, screw it. I'm going to do what I always do when my back's against the wall. I'm going to pivot. I'm going to start over. And that's what I did.
I had somebody do that too. I had this guy ask to like reach out to me wanting to edit my videos. So I gave him some videos to edit. Like I looked at his content. Everything was good. He got, like, I shared my Google Drive with him, and fuck.
Crap.
Now he's charging me money. And then he's emailing my guests saying, hey, I got your video, you know, and I was like coming unglued.
Wow.
Yeah, it was bad. I was like, what the fuck? Like, it was not good at all.
Learn your lesson.
Yeah, learn my lesson. We'll never do that again, right?
I'm sorry. But
just
yeah.
For like $25.
Yeah.
Though, like, it's so ridiculous. Like, you're hurting that fucking bad. Like, it just blew me away. I couldn't believe it. So you have some tours coming up in the States, or?
Yes, lots of touring in the States. There's a couple of dates that I'm really excited about that I wanted to play. I can't say what they are yet. But we're touring with Cheap Trick, not Cheap Trick, we're touring with Slaughter and Great White. And there's some other packages that are going to be amazing. So lots going on with Vixen for
sure. Is Lossy Loss going to be on tour with Slaughter, the drummer? Mm-hmm. Lossy Loss?
Oh, I don't
know. Do you remember him? I was in love with him.
I of course. I just did a show. I did the song Rock Candy at the NAMM show, Ronnie Montrose, and he was our drummer. It was an amazing all-star group of a band. He was playing drums in back of me. It was so cool. Yeah, I love him.
I had a little crush on him when I was growing up, for sure.
Yeah, he's really cute still. Really cute. Really handsome. Great drummer. So that's going on. And then, you know, I do a bunch of solo stuff. I mean, I've been writing, you know, all of us are writers and do our own thing as well. I have a new video coming out tomorrow with a band called Angry Hill out of Boston. I did a duet with them last year. We just did a video 3 weeks ago. It drops tomorrow night.
Oh, cool. You'll be able
to see it on my Instagram, which is Lorraine Lewis Rocks. That's coming out. And then I have a big photo session coming up with the infamous Glenn LaFerman with Kevin Gucher from Omen. We did a duet together, and that single is coming out next quarter. So I've never shot with Glenn LaFerman. I'm super excited and honored. I can't wait. That's happening on the 23rd of March. I've got some top secret things that are going on that I cannot wait to share, but I can't, so I have to just be quiet. But there's some really good magic going on for sure. And I have a new song that I wrote that I'm working on right now. It's being mixed and mastered and putting some tweaks on it. It's called Stay Human. And I'm in love with this song. It's my song of the year, I think. I really do. And when it's all done, I'm going to send it to you in any way that you can help promote it if you love it.
1,000%. Yeah.
Yeah. Because the message really is, you know, stay human. You know, the lyric, it starts out, I'm only human. I know I've made mistakes. I'm an illusion, some from confusion. I'm only human. And, I just am in love with the lyric. It just wrote itself. You know, it's really about how we're all just the same. We're all just people taking it day by day. And, you know, we're all the same. We just want to be okay. You know, we're all just human. And basically, like, you know, the love you make, be careful that the love you make isn't fake, because I'm human. So, yeah, I'm excited about that. Okay. I actually was just talking to a video director today. I'm going to do a video for it, and I'm stoked on it. So keep you posted on that. Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to play your last song. I'm going to pick. Hopefully that's okay. I just feel like this song could be fitting. You know, you made some comments. There's not a lot of amazing female artists out there. And I absolutely love Courtney Love.
Courtney Love is the real fucking deal. That song gives me chills too. It's interesting. There's been like four songs today that have just chills over my body. You know, is it the haunting chords? Is it, it's the minorness of the song? Is it Courtney's story? You know, is it her voice? Like, well, I don't know exactly what it is, but Malibu is such a haunting song. Everything about it is just, Hey. Oh God, it's just so sexy and vulnerable and mystical and edgy.
And not a lot of people listen to it. Like a lot of people go to like, you know, Celebrity Skin or whatever. And when I bought this album, I absolutely loved Malibu. That was a song that I played over and over for whatever reason. I'm always kind of drawn to that. It's like, I love people's music, but it's not so, I still love like AC/DC, She Shook Me All Night Long and all of that, but it's more like the songs that don't get played all the time.
Yeah. There's a haunting quality to Courtney in her life, her love, everything about her, her songwriting, her band. I've actually gotten to be someone I love, Sam Maloney, who played drums on that track. She was Courtney's drummer for Hole. And I love Sam Maloney. She also played with Motley Crue, you know, when Tommy was in jail. And what a badass musician. And she's doing amazing things in rock and roll. And I just love her. And to know how much I love that song and to know I know the fucking drummer of that song and she thinks I'm cool is like so cool. And when we hadn't seen each other for years. And then, because I put a band together called LA Nookie. It was kind of like one of those superstar kind of bands is what I was going for. And Lisa Leverage, who toured with Courtney, was my guitar player. And that's how I met Sam Maloney, because they were really good friends. And so I hadn't seen Sam for ages. And then Britt Lightning invited me to do the fantasy rock camp in Nashville last January. And Sam was one of the mentors along with me. And she was just so excited to see me. And we got to jam together and it was just so magical. And I remember after the whole thing was done and we were celebrating, we were having drinks at some bar, we were all gonna be flying out the next morning. And I remember one of the songs that we had played on stage was the Lita Ford, you know, I went to a party last night, I didn't get laid. And we're kind of drunk and we're in Nashville and we just left the bar and we've got our arms around each other and we're just running down, like, you know, singing and screaming the song. And what a great memory. I mean, I just have so many great memories of things like that. And I'm the type of person that really takes it in. And I don't take any of this for granted. I am honored and grateful to be the lead singer of Vixen. Who would have thought? I am so happy to be doing the things that I do and that people pay attention and that people seem to give a fuck. And I love that. Look, not everybody loves me. Trust me. I've read comments. Not everybody loves me and it's okay. But if you get to know me, you know that I'm real and I'm not, you know, yes, I love to get my hair done. Yes. I get fake eyelashes on. Yes, yes, yes. I've got fake boobs, whatever, but I'm really just me, and I'm just a girl from Albuquerque, New Mexico that had dreams and is living her best life. And you can say what you want about me, but if you know me, and if you're in my circle and you know me, you're going to know that I really am not the diva that maybe you think all of this is. I mean, I definitely have deep tendencies. I had my groceries delivered today. I hate to go to the fucking grocery store. Why would you? Why would you when you can be here and they come to you? I had roses delivered to me from the grocery store. Why wouldn't you do that? I don't want to be around a lot of people in the produce section. And I get overwhelmed by big spaces. Grocery store. No, I don't want to do that. So yeah, I have diva tendencies, but I'm pretty cool. That's all.
You are pretty cool. And I appreciate you for joining us today on Music Junkies. It was a blast. I can't wait until you go put your other songs out. We'll have you on again. Like, I'm excited to build this rapport and this relationship with you. But before I let you go, you want to give me some words of wisdom?
Words of wisdom. Yes. I have lots of words of wisdom. I've been on the planet a long time. I'm 65 years old. I know that I might piss some people off, and that's okay as long as you're living your authentic life. I know that there's people that kind of, you know, I've read comments and things and people are like, who does she think she is? Or why is she dressing like that? Or, you know, we have one life. My words of wisdom are to live your best life ever. You know, don't listen to the critics. Don't listen to anyone. Don't ask for advice. You know, really just listen to yourself. You really know what you want to do with yourself and with your life. You know the answers. Everyone that you ask for advice is going to give you advice from their perspective, and that's not your perspective. We all have what we need right here if we just pay attention to ourselves, have some alone quiet time, meditate a little bit. Yeah, that's my best advice, is live life to the fullest, live like it's going to be over tomorrow, and laugh a lot. Have fun with it. I mean, I have my cell phone out all the time taking selfies of myself. I don't care because, you know, it's just fun to document going to Starbucks. I'm sorry. It just is fun. I laugh at myself. I don't take myself seriously. Live your life to the fullest. Live your best life ever. Yeah.
I love it. Great words of wisdom. I agree. Live. Who cares what everybody thinks? You only get one life, and they're not paying your bills. They're not living in your shoes. Right. So I appreciate you. Like, follow, subscribe. I will leave all your socials. We'll keep your address under there for nobody stalks you. But she's got a big list that she needs, right? So go and buy her boots. Go buy her some clothes. She might want a Bentley. Who knows?
Oh, it's Versace.
All good.
It's Versace, baby. Versace all the way. You want a date with me? Versace. See, that sounds so diva-ish, but whatever. Anyway, I love you. You're amazing. I really was not sure about the homework that I was going to have to do for this, but it was worth every minute of it. And Music Junkies podcast. Yes. So happy to be here. Thank you so much for the time. I can't wait to be back.
Awesome.